We have HDFC Ergo, a channel partner for general insurance team today with us, And they will be telling us about group Mediclaim, which is for corporates as well as any other companies who require group medical for their staff members. And I have Sunny Budwani. He is the Associate Vice President with us. Welcome, Sunny. And he looks after the SME division. And I have Meenal Rajput. She's the underwriter who is going to take us to the training. And Minita, she is our SPOC for group medic for SME division. So over to you, Sunny, without wasting time. We've already.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can you see the screen? Meenal can see the screen.
I believe Meenal, you can just say.
Yes. Okay. Yes, great. Yes, I can see the screen.
So you can introduce Meenal and your team.
Okay. So good evening, everybody. My name is Sunny Budwani. I'm taking care of SME lines of business for the Western region of Maharashtra and Goa for HDFC Ergo General Insurance. With me today, we have Meenal Rajput, who is the senior manager in group health underwriting, which includes GMC, GP and group travel insurance. And we have Minita Karya, who is the relationship manager for Leeladhar Pasu for SME business for HDFC Ergo. So this presentation will be given by Meenal ma'am. So Meenal, over to you, since we have already passed 15 minutes. So let us not waste our time and we can just start the presentation part. Thank you, Trupti. Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, Sunny. Thank you, Trupti. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me just quickly run you through the presentation. So as we all know, group Mediclaim is a very common product. It's a very known product to each most of the agents. As in, everybody would know that Mediclaim haan hota hai, chahe wo retail policy ho ya group policy ho. Theek hai? So I just wanted one thing in question. Would everybody will be comfortable in English or should
yeah,
I?
Yeah, I mean in English because we have a South team also. So English.
Acha, okay. English is more preferable.
Many don't know what is group medical. So you'll have to explain exactly.
Okay, okay.
They do have clients for group medical. They do ask me quotes.
Mm-hmm.
They should okay. know. Basically, we'll start with the, you know, basic training.
Basic, okay, yeah. Okay, okay. So, as we know, Mediclaim is a policy whereby any claims for which Mediclaim policy. So, when we say Mediclaim policy, it could be a group policy or it could be a retail policy. Right now, we are particularly dealing with a group policy. So, the definition of a group is a set of people who are working for an organization. Okay, and they come together and then they purchase a policy for everybody's benefit. So it is actually a pool whereby people pay premium and every individual of that
Meenal, your voice is breaking.
Am I audible?
Yeah, now you're audible.
Yes, So that's the definition of a group. So right now what we deal, the most common type of group is an employer-employee relationship group, whereby an employer has some interest in the health or in the well-being of his employees. Only if his employees are safe and healthy, then his employees can work for the organization and bring some benefit to the organization. Okay, na? So in that scenario, the employer takes group insurance, group Mediclaim policy for his employees. Now, along with the employees are also connected to his dependents. Obviously, if the dependents in the family are well, then the employee would be able to work effectively in the organization. So the employer would extend that benefit to the employee as well as the employee's dependents, immediate dependents. Now, the employee's immediate dependents would include spouse, children, and parents. Okay? So these relationships are what we can cover in the group definition policy. So as per IRDA guideline, the minimum count of lives that are required for a group Mediclaim policy is 7 lives, okay? And we internally have certain guidelines for giving this group policy. So that we will come at a later stage. Now what happens-
Meenal, isn't it changed? 10? No, now minimum lives was 7.
No, it is 7 only.
7 only.
No, it is still 7 only. Yes, yes. It is still 7. Okay. So when we say that this group has been formed, so we typically do deal with employer-employee relationship type of group. And also, maybe in a few cases, it could be a non-employer-employee relationship also. But majority, 95% of the cases are employer-employee. So when we say this, the groups have been formed, it should not have been formed with the sole purpose of availing insurance. Okay. Trupti, you can skip to the second slide. So I think that would help what qualifies as a group. I think, third slide, what qualifies as a group? Ahead. Why group mediclaim is just a general introduction. We can skip this. Go ahead. Here. What qualifies as a group? So now when we say that the common purpose of making a group is that everybody should be engaged in a common activity. As I said, example is an employer-employee group. So a particular organization, say for example, a company like HDFC Ergo takes a group mediclaim insurance for its employees. So all the employees are in the process of securing insurance for its clients and customers, okay? So that is the activity of that particular client. Similarly, they all have a common purpose, that is working for the organization, for the benefit of the organization. Organizer has the authority for majority of the members to arrange for insurance. The organizer, he will only set whether he wants to cover for the dependents or not. Group should not be formed for the sole purpose of availing insurance, which means it should be the case that the purpose of making the group is only insurance. The group, other than in getting insurance, the other purpose of the group should have some other activity as well. So main purpose should be some activity, whether a profitable activity or non-profitable activity, whatever activity they are into, that should be another. So there should be some work going on and not only for the purpose of insurance. And the minimum group size is 7, as I said. Okay, let us move on ahead. Who could be covered under the policy? The employer takes the policy for its employees and their dependents, spouse, children, and parents, or parents-in-law for that matter. Or even affinity groups can take insurance. For example, a club takes insurance for its club members. That type of insurance is known as affinity group insurance. So here, employer-employee relationship is not there, but then obviously the club has a vested interest in the well-being of its club members. That is how it would take. Let us move on to the... So while we say when we... definition of the spouse and children and parents. So children we cover up to the age of 18, or parents we cover up to the age of 80. While the children now, so obviously most of the children are studying and go for postgraduate courses also. So a particular time limit of covering the children has been increased to 25 years. So it is ideally from 3 months to 25 years. But since it is a group mediclaim policy, it's a tailor-made policy, you can also get baby covered from day one. So obviously there are other loadings which are applicable to that. Let us move on. Now, key features of the policy. So inpatient hospitalization, obviously when hospitalization occurs, when a person is sick, he goes to the hospital. Whatever are the hospital charges which are there are covered under the group mediclaim policy. Okay, free hospitalization with up to 30 days, which means before going to the hospital, probably when the person falls sick, he goes to a local doctor. He would advise him certain checkups, diagnostic tests or something, or maybe give him some more medicines in the first stage. Then if he's again not well, then he would refer him to the hospital. So whatever expenses are incurred before getting admitted to the hospital, those expenses are being paid as pre-hospitalization. And such expenses would be up to 30 days prior to the hospitalization. Okay, then we come to post-hospitalization. So even after getting the discharge, the doctor would again give you certain medicines to be taken, or maybe a repeat test, whether you have been cured of that ailment or not. Again, a repeat test, some diagnostic tests would be recommended, or maybe physiotherapy or any such kind of things would be recommended. So such kind of expenses would come as a part of post-hospitalization. And these are payable up to 60 days after the date of discharge. Okay. Then we have domiciliary hospitalization expenses also payable. So like in the current situation where beds are not available, or maybe the situation of the patient is such that he cannot be moved out of the house. If he is moving out of the house, then it could deteriorate his health or condition. So in such cases, domiciliary hospitalization is also payable. Daycare procedures. So due to the advancement of science, a lot of hospitalization or a lot of procedures and surgeries have become of a very short period. Recoveries are faster. So in such cases, hospitalization is not mandated. They do not need monitoring or observing by a medical staff. So hence they are treated for that particular ailment and then they are allowed to go home. So such procedures are called as daycare procedures, which does not require 24 hours of hospitalization. So such kind of daycare procedures are also covered under the policy. Then we have organ donor expenses. So in case if a donor has been found out and the surgery for transplantation of a particular organ is to be done, then the expenses of the donor would also get covered under the policy. So we will have to enroll that donor and then we will have to pay for his surgery and medical costs also. However, the cost of the organ is not covered. So in case if somebody is paying a hefty amount as a cost of the organ, that is not payable under insurance. But however, whatever are the hospitalization expenses, surgery expenses for that particular donor, those will get covered. Emergency ambulance expenses are covered with a sublimit. Okay. So ambulance expenses are also covered from taking the patient from the home to a particular hospital or from one hospital to another hospital. Most of the times, ambulance charges are not payable on the return journey or the recovery journey to the home. Let us move on further. We come to maternity expenses. So maternity expenses are covered under the policy. As we said, these are tailor-made policies. Group Mediclaims are tailor-made policies. So these policies can be tailored by giving maternity expenses or by not giving maternity expenses. There could be a variation in the sum insured of the maternity expenses. So those, trial and errors and outfits can be changed according to the client's requirements or according to the experience of what the client demands. That can be changed accordingly. Similarly, we have pre and postnatal expenses. Here, what is happening is prenatal is covered up to
Meenal, your voice is again gone.
Sorry. Yeah. So prenatal expenses are covered from the date of conceiving till the date of delivery, and postnatal expenses are covered up to 6 days after the date of delivery. A newborn baby can be covered from day one up to the family sum insured limit. Ayush, that is Ayurvedic, Unani, Homeopathy and Siddha, these are also covered under the policy. These are optional covers, and this can be covered. They can be covered with putting some sublimits on the policy. In that way, corporate buffer. Now, when we say corporate buffer, it is like a additional sum insured which is purchased by the organization. Okay. So, in case if one of the employees would exhaust his existing sum insured limit, then an additional sum insured can be procured and can be given to the employee, can be allocated to the employee. Okay. So in that way, a corporate buffer would be beneficial. So that would depend upon the HR or the admin of the particular organization who is being insured, for them to confirm who would be benefiting out of that corporate buffer. So usually this corporate buffer is taken at the inception of the policy only. waiting period waiver. So unlike the retail policies where we have a 30-day waiting period, 1-year waiting period, or 2-year waiting period, and 4 years waiting period for pre-existing diseases, here in the group medical claim policy, since it is tailor-made, these waiting periods can be waived off. So there would be applicable loading charges accordingly, but this can be waived off. So we can get the cover right from day one. And also these 1 or 2 years waiting period, like cataract, hysterectomy, and all those.
So this will be with additional premium, right?
This will be with additional premium. Yes, yes. Let's move on. Underwriting guidelines. Now, what differs is basically, so when we say this, IRDA has given permission from covering up from minimum of 7 lives. Yes, they have given permission. But then obviously it is not very feasible to give all coverages to all stratas of the organizations, or maybe for all levels of the group units. So what we have done is segregated them in a particular bunch wise. So when we say small groups, which means less than 50 lives, you we would be able to give them standard cover. Now, standard cover, which would mean pre-existing disease would not be covered, waiting periods would be applicable, maternity benefit would not be covered. That would be a standard cover, a plain vanilla cover, basically. And 51 and above, we would be able to give them a comprehensive cover with pre-existing disease coverage and maternity coverage. Okay, maybe corporate buffer also if required. So from 51 and above, we will be able to give a comprehensive coverage. Up to less than 50 lives, we would restrict giving all coverages, because then it is not feasible. The premium would be very high for a very less set of employees, and probably in terms of claims also, the claims for one particular life would also be costing more. So that could have an adverse impact on the profitability of the policy. So that's the reason we curtail these coverages. Now, when we say we cover parents also, so there is a particular ratio which is to be adhered. So which means basically we would not allow selection of parents. We would not allow voluntary coverage of parents. There has to be a ratio of 1.6 or minimum 1.5 to get the parents being covered under the policy.
Meenal, can you elaborate this point, because this is always confusing.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when we say the parent-employee ratio, we would divide the count, total count of parents by the total number of employees. Okay. And here the ratio, that division answer should be 1.5 and above. Then it is said to be a healthy ratio, where we say that, okay, everybody is not covering all parents. Obviously, everybody may not be having all both set of parents there, but at least a decent set whereby selection of risk is not happening. It should not be voluntary. What happens is, in voluntary policies, people would obviously try to take insurance for those who know that, yes, they are like more likely to get claims in the upcoming years, or more likely in that unhealthy state of affair. So there the selection would be there. So I would be taking premium for only those people who would want to claim under the policy. I will not be getting a pool of people, you know, one set of healthy people and one set of unhealthy people. That will not be there. The combination will not be there. So we would mostly avoid for selection policies to be taken. We do not entertain most of these policies. Then we come to the decline list of groups. Now the decline list of groups is quite a long group. We'll share those guidelines also separately. And the decline list, basically what we do not cover is media. We do not cover news channels. We do not cover print media. Okay. And law firms, hospitals, diagnostic centers, those kind of industries are our declined risk of groups, which we do not cover. So here what happens is...
Why law firms? Can you just elaborate? Law firms
we try to avoid, because then there is a lot of arm twisting which happens with law firms. Bahut zyada gyan bhi ati gyan phir bhari pad jata hai. And that's the reason we avoid law firms.
Okay.
pricing wise and everything, so obviously pricing would depend upon what the demography is, what is the sum insured being offered, and what are the coverages being asked for. So pricing is a separate game altogether, and pricing is different for each and every group, for each and every client. Standard RFQ format compulsory before binding. So there's a RFQ format which IRDA has mandated. So that is compulsory before binding the proposal. Earlier we used to ask it for even underwriting the proposals, but now we have relaxed it. So we are asking it only at the time of binding, maybe because all proposals do not bind. Preferred segments are obviously IT companies, manufacturing companies. All those are our preferred segments. Fresh policies, first time buy segments are also preferred. And then policies with no parents or exposure preferred. So what happens is basically with parents policies or parents being included in the policies, obviously the claims go a little higher and the premiums are lesser. So what happens is the loss ratios are affected. The overall profitability goes for a toss. So 1+3, self, spouse and children, that's the ideal set of policy family members that are to be covered. Or we can take insurance only for self also. A lot of companies are doing insurance only for their employees these days because of the increasing costs. We can move ahead. Yeah. Okay. Then we come to the caution list. As I explained, the caution lists are there. Can read through. So diagnostic centers, hospitals, and all these are basically avoided. Diagnostic centers and hospitals are basically avoided because there are a lot of soft frauds which happen under such policies. That's the reason they are avoided. Politicians, obviously, a loud mouth. Politicians and lawyers both. Religious trusts, which are involved in charities, are also not covered. Multi-level marketing, MLM marketing wala companies, media companies, these are not covered. Standalone policies for retirees or standalone policies for only parents, they are also not covered under the group policies. So the basic reason for not covering retired employees or standalone policies is if I'm not writing their base policy, the base employees policy, I obviously do not have a insurable interest towards covering the retired employees. The organization has an interest in covering the retired employees, but I do not have that insurable interest wala part ki base employees to hai hi nahi aur main retired walon ko cover kar rahi hu. People who are not working with the organization, they are being covered under the policy, right? So that's the reason they are not covered on standalone basis. If they are there in the organization and the organization wants to take policies for them, they are always welcome. We can give a coverage for retired employees as well as parents as well. We move on to the exclusions. So things or situations which are not covered in the policy are known as exclusions. So these are the list common exclusions which are there even in retail policies and also in the group policies. Suicide is not covered. Abuse of or intake of alcohol is not covered. HIV AIDS related diseases are not covered. Venereal diseases are not covered. Psychiatric and mental disorders were not covered, but I think with the new guidelines, psychiatric and mental disorders are covered under the policy. Treatment for obesity or cosmetic in nature are not covered. Infertility treatments are not covered. External congenital diseases, which means diseases which are there by birth, are not covered, but which are external. External means on the skin. They are not covered. Medically unnecessary hospitalization, which means a person who is feeling a little low, not quite well, he would just go and get admitted to the hospital, get a saline drip, and which was actually not necessary. He could have just had a glucose or maybe a few medicines, which could be tablets, and he could have felt better. So hospitalizations which are not medically necessary are not payable under the policy. Unproven or experimental type of treatment, such things are also not payable. So basically, when we say there has to be an active line of treatment covered under the hospitalization, or active line of treatment to for the daycare procedure also. Some action has to happen where you know, the patient is actually unwell, and then some treatment is being given which would make the patient feel well. Let's move on. So these are the set of requirements which are mandatory for a fresh proposal when we quote for a fresh proposal. Obviously, the name of the client. So we do not entertain giving quotes on unnamed basis. We do not entertain giving quotes for like ABC organization, XYZ organization. No, we need to know the name of the client in the first place. What is the client? What is of the client? And it should not be like there may be multiple proposals going on with that client and multiple different quotes being released out to the same client with different names. So in that, to avoid such scenarios, we would want to know the actual original name of the client before we quote. Business of the insured person, obviously, what is the business activity of that client, the total employee strength and the total insured strength, which means just to confirm that the insurance is not being taken selectively. Demographic details, that is age, gender, relationship, sum insured and coverage details, family definition, obviously, and confirmation on the basis of sum insured or family definition criteria. Either the employer decides to give a flat sum insured to all employees, or maybe he could give a graded sum insured as per the designations of his employees, or maybe as per the tenure in the organization of the employees, whatever. So we need to know the basis of the sum insured at the inception, at the time of quoting the policy.
So team, this is the requirement always which I ask you all for a group medical. So you have to share these details, then only these tailor-made quotations are made. So please keep in mind, I will share this presentation also to everybody. So these things are compulsory to get a quote.
Yes, right. Absolutely mandatory. We move on to the requirements for the rollover quotation. So quotations where the organization already has an experience and they are taking the insurance for the second or third time, whatever. This is not the first time proposal for the rollover cases. Let's move on quickly. So here we say that all information which are listed in the fresh case should be provided. Obviously, the name of the organization, what is the business of the organization, the demography of the group that is being covered, family definition. All those set of information is required here at the data level. Along with this data, we would also require some additional more information about their previous policy, right? The current policy which they are enjoying. So the policy period, what they have, policy period is basically the policy start date and the end date of the current policy. A detailed claims dump would be required. The existing policy, who has claimed under the policy, or what are the type of claims that have come under the policy. So a detailed claims dump along with their date of admission, date of discharge, ailment details, what was the claimed amount, what was the settled amount, and whether it was cashless, reimbursement, all those type of details are required while we quote. So those details are there in a detailed claims dump only. So we ask for a detailed claims dump, which is in Excel. Without that Excel file, we will not be able to quote. A few of the organizations, a few of the TPAs would give only a summary or an analysis kind of a thing. So we usually do not quote on that analysis kind of thing, because that just gives you a rough idea. That does not give you an implicate idea on what is the IBNR, which is on the policy, or what is the inflation under the policy. Those details cannot be derived from the analysis or the MIS wala PDF summaries. So we usually ask for a detailed claims dump only. Only then we can quote. Now, claims recon date is the date on which that particular MIS has been extracted. So this MIS is up to what date is basically the claims recon date. Lives at inception and expiry. Say, for example, when the organization took the policy last year, what was the count of lives that were covered in that at that point of time, and over the period of 1 year, what is now the count of lives which are to be covered. expiring coverages, obviously, when we say that X number of claims have been settled for an X amount of claims, then what has been covered under the policy is what is also to be known. Like, what was the sum insured, family definition, what were the benefits which were there under the policy, whether PE was covered, maternity was covered, whether co-payments were applicable or room rent restrictions were applicable. All those types of coverages also which are there in the current policy, those also need to be elaborated. So the best thing is you all share the policy copy. That would give us a detailed information about the inception number of lives, the coverages under the policy start date, end date. All of those information gets covered in the policy schedule itself. So if that is being shared, that's the best thing. Instead of writing all the coverages on a RFQ, making it as a PPT or something like that. Or maybe in case, yes, RFQ is required, in case if options are required to be given under the policy. Or any change in the coverages compared to the expiry, as compared to the expiry. As I said, last year, maybe a co-payment was applicable. Now the insured employer wants that co-payment should be removed, or maybe co-payment should be increased. Room rents, which were there, some ailment restrictions, which were there, that need to be increased or decreased. All those sets of coverage comparison needs to be checked while we quote. So, we need to establish what were the expiring coverages and what are the proposed coverages. That is very important at the time of quoting. Okay, then we move on to the next slide. These are basically claim servicing slides, whereby how many claims are there, how do we go about the network hospitalization and the cashless and reimbursement procedures. All of those things gets covered in the few slides. What we also have is the mobile application facility. If you could scroll ahead, I think Trupti, you can scroll ahead. Health claim services. How is HDFC Ergo it is one of the best health claim services being offered in the industry right now. So cashless claims are the best claims that get filled very easily, quickly, without much hassles to the patient and their families. We also have this IPO mobile app. If you can scroll this slide. Network service providers which are there. So these details of network service providers basically are where we have a lot of network hospitals. So this list of network hospitals can be accessed on our website. Obviously, when the employer takes the policy along with their e-medicards, they will get all those details as well. So these details are available online and offline both ways. Next slide, which is mobile app. Now here we also have this mobile app whereby you can register claims, check status of your claims, and a lot of other details which are there regarding to the policy, your health card generation and all of those details. These are easily and handily available in the mobile applications also. Then we have value-added services. Now, value-added services would include a lot of pharmacy discounts. Trupti, we can move to the next slide. So I am not getting into the nitty-gritties and details of all of these value-added services. You all can have a look. What is basically a lot of pharmacy discounts are there. Preventive health checkup discounts and all those types of discounts are there available, which one can go on the sites and get that educated along with it. So with this, we come to an end of the group MediClaim presentation. Now, let us move ahead with the question and answer round. So I'm sure a lot of people will be having questions in between.
Team, you all can put your questions on the chat board, please. Any questions, team? Meenal, one question is asked. Is dementia covered under MediClaim?
dementia would basically mean whereby a person, you know, gets a little memory loss or something. That's dementia, right? Mental problems. So mental problems, as per the new IRDA guidelines, obviously psychiatric and psychosomatic treatments are covered under the policy. But as we say, they are covered under the policy, but then obviously that goes under the hospitalization part. If there is a treatment, a hospitalization and an active line of treatment being given for that particular ailment, then obviously it gets covered.
So it will be covered, right? In short.
So hospitalization for dementia and an active line of treatment being given for dementia.
No, Dhyaneshwar has not understood. He couldn't elaborate, please.
Yeah. What I mean to say, when most of the psychological problems or psychosomatic problems are being treated on OPD basis. So if the treatment is taken on OPD basis, it is not covered under the policy. If the treatment is being taken on hospitalization basis, there is some observation and there's some treatment, some medication being given to the patient, some medication being administered to the patient, whereby monitoring by the medical staff is required. Only in such cases, psychosomatic hospitalizations are payable. So dementia would come under that category.
So basically, it should be hospitalization.
Basically, it should be hospitalization. Yes.
Are you okay? They are clear, Dhyaneshwar? Yeah. Okay. Any more questions, team? You all have understood what requirements are needed to give group medical codes, right? Both new and rollover. We'll wait for 2 seconds.
No issues. I am also wondering why are people so quiet if they're not asking questions.
Any more questions, team, or should I wind up? Sunny, would you like to add something? Are Sunny chala gaya kya?
I think Sunny is not there on call.
He's not there.
Not there.
Anyway, thanks Meenal and Minita for sharing this presentation and making us understand what is group medical. We shall definitely get in touch with Sunny's team to give us quotes. Existing group medical policies are there with us, with HDFC Ergo. Minita is aware of it. Thanks a lot once again. And thank you team for joining. So, we can end this.
Thank you, Trupti. Thank you for giving this platform whereby we can reach out to these agents as well.
Yes.
As whenever there are any doubts or difficulties pertaining to any quotes, you can definitely reach us out.
Yes, sure. Yes, Vinita.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Please be in touch in case of any requirements.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, team.
Thank you, Trupti. Thank you, Vinita.